13th of October. I was traveling from New Delhi to Kuala Lumpur because I had to attend a conference which was organized jointly by the United Nations and government of Malaysia. Basically, I was invited and selected for a program titled Children and Youth Assembly. But while I was at the immigration, while I was getting my passport stamped, the immigration officer started inquiring about me. Like when he found that I'm from Kashmir, he started digging more. Like what do I do? Where I am going and why I am going. I had to hide that I am a journalist because two of my friends were already offloaded for moving into moving overseas, and I didn't want it to miss this chance because I was selected as a delegate from India, and it was a opportunity for me to represent India, and I have earlier participated in international conference, so I didn't wanted to lose this kind of chance, keeping in view that already there is a situation in Kashmir from at least from 3 months. The situation in Kashmir is not we cannot call it, the government even says that it is normal but it's not peaceful. So keeping that thing in view, I thought it would be better for me just to tell them I am a tourist, and generally as tourists we are allowed. So I told them in a neutral thing because I didn't want to be in any kind of serious debate with them why you are going. Then they will pose questions. You are going to a conference in Malaysia for United Nations. Keeping in view of the situation, the recently the Prime Minister of Malaysia, he also spoke about he made a statement about Kashmir that India is illegally occupied Kashmir. I thought, you know, I'll be caught in a debate with them, so I tried to hide this thing from them that I'm a journalist and human rights activist. But yeah, I told them the other part of the story that I told them that was also absolutely true. That I told them that I'm a businessman. I am a businessman too. I run a small business in Srinagar, and also I mentioned that I'm going there for a tourism leisure. For leisure, also I'm visiting a university, which again it's true. And I showed them my. I showed them my phone. I showed them the conversation between me and the university in Malaysia. And I thought, you know, it will be a win-win situation for me that I will go for I will attend conference, and subsequently I'll be visiting the university. And during that time, whenever they were questioning, they're probing. First, they stamped my passport. You can see there's a stamp. They're stamped my passport, and after that, after some time, he told me that he's going inside. He has to, you know, inquiry a bit more about this thing. So I told him, is everything okay? Is already, what is the problem with, what is the issue with my passport? Is the visa okay? Is there any issue? Just let me know. He was no, wait, I'm coming. And after 1 or 2 minutes, he came back and he told me just to follow him. I followed him, and it took almost more than it took 2 hours for them to decide, and in the end they came up with this shocking news that I'm being offloaded, and they had rejected this boarding pass that I already had made. I was told that I was offloaded. I was pressing more to know about this, that why I have been offloaded. Just tell me the reason. They said they cannot share the reason with me. I said I have every right to travel as a citizen of India. Every citizen. If there is anything bad on me or something if I have done any crime or something like that, it's okay. Just tell me. But they said they cannot tell me. So what kind of justice is this that they are disallowing me to travel overseas? And my apprehensions came true. The fear that I had that I will tell them I am a journalist and they won't allow. And see, they are not allowing me while when I told them I'm a tourist, I'm a businessman. They're not allowing me for being a neutral person who's visiting Malaysia. They didn't allow me. And tell me how come they would have allowed me if I would have told them I'm a journalist? They would have obviously rejected the visa at the very first instance had they received my passport. And the next thing they did, I was having documents. I was having some documents in my hand, visa and everything, booking, and even they said they need an ID to check out my credentials. They were saying like this passport is fake. I said, how come you can check out? You can me. It is not. They didn't told me that this is fake. But yeah, because they were checking it that way, they were checking it again and again, and they said, let me check this passport once more. And I gave him my driving license, and they haven't returned. I told them when after 2 hours, I was frustrated, totally frustrated in anger. I told them just return my documents. They already returned just two things, this boarding pass and passport. The rest of the things they kept with them. I forgot to mention my license. I don't know. I wanted my license back. I don't know what they are gonna do. They stopped me because I'm a Kashmiri. There is a tag on my back that I'm a Kashmiri. I'm in Kashmiri activist journalist. After realizing that they should have checked reject my background, and they would have come to know that I'm a journalist, and they rejected the approval, the because there was a stamp which they had, like I will show you if it is visible. There was a stamp. They first the immigration people put in stamp on me. And then on the second instance, when they would have realized what they would have learned that I'm a journalist and human rights activist, they stopped me because they don't want Kashmiris or journalists particularly, because my friend Gawar Gilani was also stopped from traveling overseas. The reason is quite obvious, because they don't want the world to know what's happening in Kashmir. Kashmir has been there has been shut down from the last 3 months. The communication has resumed after 70 days. Kashmir has become a quite frustrating place where the business is no more. The transporters are also on kind of there's a so the people have shut down their shops, and people have the public the commercial transport is not on the roads. The commercial transport is not playing on the roads. The reason is because people are angry with whatever has happened in Kashmir. They're angry with the abrogation of the Article 370. So in a way, the people are protesting silently. And the other thing that you posed questions about Kashmir was the situation. The situation in Kashmir is there is a cold peace right now, because the Kashmir has turned into a big garrison. There's the presence of army is growing, and thousands of people have been detained on the pretext that they want to maintain law and order. In the name of law and order, they have arrested many people. There have been reports of torture. There have been so there is the fear psychosis. They have created a fear psychosis in Kashmir. And the other hand, the Kashmiri anger is brewing, and it can sprout anytime like a volcano. Right now, the presence of army is growing. They are building bunkers in Kashmir. So in a way, they are trying to scare Kashmiris Well, at one point of time, if you try to scare your people, you are forcing them, you're arresting them, you're torturing them, you're building fear among them. And one day this fear, the fear factor will not work, because the anger will overcome the fear, and that day you will feel there will be a catastrophe. There will be a total chaos. Of course, there will be killings. Internet is, while they have resumed mobile phones after 70 days, but internet is still not working in Kashmir. And you understand the sanctity of internet in this 21st century, when the education, the business, all kinds of things, the communication things, they depend on this internet. And you have snapped internet, and schools are closed. Very important thing that the schools and colleges are still non-functional. And I was shocked to see the college where I have studied. I used to park my car there. So last time when I went there, it is Sri Pratap College in Srinagar, and I saw a big bunker that has been built outside my college where I used to study. And the army man is stopping me. Hey, where are you going? And army man, imagine the army man stopping me to enter my college. You know, why they are there, I don't understand why they are outside the college. What is their role? You know, college is for students, not for army. You can give them a better place to stay, but why college? So I was like, you know, they told me, just don't park your car inside. So the kind of situation we are talking is, it is quite horrible, terrible. It's really heartrending. It's really tough. There is tough life. There is uncertainty. There is tension that is brewing all the time. And yes, they were, the shops were running out of medicine at the beginning. Now, things have started little bit, normalizing. But I don't think so that this thing is going to work. And the other important thing that I want to tell you is that media, which is the backbone of democracy, you will see that the media people have restrictions in Kashmir. Like, I am as a journalist, I can be stopped by police while I am doing my work as a journalist. I can be stopped by the army, and they can beat us, which has happened to my friends, which has been reported, that army and police harassing journalists in Kashmir when they are on their duty, when they are on their professional duties. So anyway, it's like, for journalists, it's a risky job. And for people, you can understand, the people who are, in far-flung areas, we really don't know what was going on around, because there was communication blockade. Now the communication has resumed, we'll come to know more about what exactly had happened, who died, because there were reports and shot pellets on his face, and he's succumbed to his injuries later. There was an official document from the hospital that the boy died because of pellet injuries, which the government denies and says that the boy died with the stone. The family says the boy died with pellets. So we have these kind of reports also, whether deaths have taken place. So, but we don't know, that needs to be investigated. And like in this case of pellet victim that died because of pellets, we had this official document and the family statement to basically confirm that he died because of pellets. If you want me to define the situation in Kashmir, I will say in a way that India is losing Kashmir day by day. You see the mainstream people who used to, they are also feeling the same heat. We had all the lobbies in Kashmir, like by the separatists, the mainstream, the other pro-Kashmiri lobby. All the lobbies speak one thing in Kashmir, that they are unhappy with the government decision. So all on the ground, I can say one thing, that this that India is losing Kashmir day by day, and the alienation, the anger is brewing. It can take any kind of twist in future.
Take a TV, the voice of the voiceless. Like it and click on following, and click on see first, then you will get all the new notifications and updates.